sometimes even if I was having a day where I would think, how do I do this today? And I know this sounds really funny, but there's always a part of me that went, make this call once you're changed. See if you can't do it then.
Right, right.
And I would always get changed and think, I can do it. It just helped me plug right into the, I guess, like the whole circuitry of the period, the show, the scene, the truth. I'm Elizabeth Debicki and I'm playing Princess Diana.
And I am Sid Roberts and I'm the associate designer and head buyer.
Head buyer?
I knew, you know what? A lot of people would not realize how much we make.
You mean as opposed to thinking that it's bought from somewhere?
Yeah. 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 I remember a friend of mine, when Amy and me, this sounds really, when me and Amy won an Emmy, her mum said, but what did they do? They just bought everything. Because we're coming closer to where we are now. Mm. And so I think that would be a misconception.
I guess like everything with The Crown, the sort of quest to get the closest to the core of these people, the core of the story, the authentic truth of what we're sort of talking about with the show.
I think it's a fine line that you're treading on because you're dealing with real people and so you want to honour them, but also you want to honour the script and the story that we're telling as well. So I feel like in a way, and we say this often, if we reference dresses like the revenge dress, then we, when we go to private spaces, we've built a trust. So people will come with us. Rules. So what I want to say, so this period of time, 6 years, last year was like 13. But a lot happens in that time. And so I think in order to make those 6 years, her kind of costume trajectory feel clearer, we came up with some very clear rules. For example, episodes 1 to 5, we only had her in long. The long skirts, the pleated skirts, the prettier, the softer shapes, the patterns, and the cricket jumpers. All of that slouchy kind of stuff. And then there's this slightly kind of in-between time where the skirts kind of go knee-length. And then at the end, the skirts get shorter and the silhouette becomes much simpler. And for example, she wore a lot of stonewashed jeans. And of course, in the later dates, she would have worn them, but in order to make that story much clearer, we just made those rules that she wouldn't wear a long skirt in episode 10. It's the cricket jumper look, I'd say. Mm. It's where everything's much baggier, much looser. Mm. And I did want to ask you about that character-wise. Mm. Do you think there was a sense of hiding or wanting to conceal her body?
Yes. Yes, not because of the way it looked.
Right.
But because of a sense of, a kind of formlessness.
Right.
And I think that somehow mirrored a need to let yourself be undone. I guess this is the most undone in a way. We are going to Italy. That's a kind of moment where we first see Diana with the boys and meeting Charles and finding out that the second honeymoon that's been sort of promised to her is in fact really like a press opportunity for Camp Charles. It's interesting because that epiphany happens after getting dressed. And so I always felt that there was something about that she did look really beautiful and it looked summery, but it's still very young.
I think also there's a real optimism.
Yeah,
because as you say, it's before
that
moment.
There's a sense of hope, you know.
Yeah, you think you're going on a second honeymoon.
It also feels like one of the things that Sid was saying before, where there's in this moment in the story, there's a sort of crossover between season 4 and season 5, and we're still in that sort of territory of the two of them blending together and the two time periods, in a way, the sort of 80s and 90s blend coming together. And I really feel like that dress captures that as well. So she wore this to an event at the Serpentine Gallery on the night that Prince Charles's interview with Jonathan Dimbleby was airing on television. And so pointedly, instead of being anywhere less visible, which might imply that she was watching it, so she made a point of being in this incredibly public space and also being photographed looking beyond incredible, knowing this would also capture the attention of the media and that would be what the press would most likely run with on a front page and be able to contrast an admission of adultery with her looking a squillion bucks.
Hence where it was coined the revenge dress. Yeah.
There's lots of things about the recreation of that moment that were nerve-wracking, I suppose. It's this amazing moment. And she just looks incredible. Obviously, underneath it, or the thing that is fueling it, is so much tumult, almost at the very other end of what of the spectrum of what she is feeling versus what she's portraying. And the fact that she was able to do that so flawlessly is testament to her capacity to perform a role and be what people needed, and also convince people of one thing and feel the opposite.
I mean, it's an extraordinary design without us needing to do very much to it. I mean, you couldn't have put her in anything else. There's no way she's going to the Serpentine and we rewrite history and she wears a bright pink dress.